Hello, beloved of the Lord. What a joy it is again to come to you this wonderful Friday evening, and trusting that you're ready to receive the Word of God, and the Word is going to build you up and give you the inheritance that belongs to the saints of God. This Friday evening, the Lord is with us and He's going to lead us. The Holy Spirit is going to lead us into all truth. So why don't we start with a word of prayer and thanking Him for His wonderful grace upon us and the Word that is with us. I'd like to welcome all of you and also our family, Redemption Family Church in Fort Myers, Florida. Lord's blessing on all of you. So glad that you all could come and be with us tonight. And from wherever else you're tuning in, we welcome you in Jesus' precious name. Father, we come before you and give you all the glory and thank you for your goodness, for your love, for your mercy, for your grace upon us, and that you have given us the truth so that we may know who you are and know who Jesus is. And by the power of your Spirit, through your word, may know the inheritance that we have in you, in Christ. In Jesus' precious name we pray. And thank you for your saints, wherever they are at, O God. Thank you for those hungry hearts for your truth. In Jesus' name I pray and give you all the glory. Amen. Well, I'll tell you what, today is a joyful day to me, because today I send my book, our Sonship, out to the print. And I believe with all of my heart that this book is going to change a lot of lives. God's Word going forth, the power of Almighty God. And I believe that God has called us to be world changers. And I believe you and I together, we could do this with this amazing message that God has given us. You know, we have just concluded last week our teaching on the subject of the ministry of the Lord Jesus at the right hand of the Father. And I was in prayer several weeks ago for our Sunday morning service, Persian service. And in my spirit, something came up so strong that I had never heard it before concerning faith. And I think it is a good time for us to get into this subject. So I want to talk about this subject, the faith of two covenants. The faith of two covenants. The faith that people operated in the Old Testament, under the law of Moses, and prior to the law of Moses, and in the faith that we operate today, based upon the new covenant, the faith of Lord Jesus that is in us. I believe this is so important teaching, and there's so much confusion about this subject, and so many people lately that have come to me, they say, Pastor, I don't know, how do I do this? How do I get my healing? How do I get these blessings that God has given to me in Christ Jesus? What do I need to do? One person said to me, said, I believe, I'm believing. I said, sure you are. You have faith. Every believer has faith. But how do I do this? How do I get the promises of God in the spiritual realm, in the promised realm, and make it, because up to that point, that is in the promised realm, it's legally ours, belongs to us, blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now, that's a reality, but that reality, it's a theory to us, unto the point that we have made it a reality into all realm. Right now, it's legally ours. It's like this. Somebody in your family passes away and they give you a tremendous inheritance. You receive a letter from an attorney that they request your presence in their office. You go to the attorney's office and there they hand you a document. They say your great-grandpa or your uncle or your cousin, somebody, gave you a tremendous inheritance. You inherited $10 million. Wouldn't you be happy that day? I'd be tap dancing. And So here's yours. Just sign underneath these paper. So legally, what they have given you will be yours. The moment you sign it, legally, you are multimillionaire, $10 million of it. But practically, you're no more than that old Joe or old Jack that had nothing. Hey, Jack, you got nothing right now. Legally, yes. It's all in your inheritance. It's all legally issued. You signed the paper. Your name is under it. But practically, you have to go and possess that which legally has been yours. They're not going to come and shove it down your throat and say, here's $10 million with a bag at the door, knock on the door, give it to you. Nobody does that. So you have to go and possess and take care of, take an action toward that which is yours. So the same way in the spiritual things, God in Christ has given us a tremendous inheritance here on the earth. Divine, His divine power, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, has provided for us all things pertaining to life and godliness. Everything that you need to serve God, everything that you need to live a wholesome life on this earth, a blessed life, God in Christ Jesus has already provided it for us. What we need to do, grab that which is in heaven. Grab that which is legally Jesus provided it. Sign underneath those papers and go possess it. Make it ours. How do we do this? By faith. Because the Bible says the righteous shall live by faith. Now, again, the key is for us to understand the operation of faith. As we have said before, there are two kinds of faith. There are two covenants of faith. A covenant of the old had its own faith, and the covenant of the new covenant, has its own faith. So often people confuse these two covenants and its bylaws and its tools, and they try to get a result. That's why Christians do not get results, because they are using a tool for a wrong covenant. They are using a tool that was only applicable under the old covenant and not under the new covenant. We want to talk about this. So write this down. If you have paper and pen, write this down. So we're talking about two kinds of faith. One faith, number one, that belonged to the old, prior to Jesus' death, as a matter of fact, prior to the day of Pentecost, things changed. Legally, Jesus provided everything through His death, burial, and resurrection. Practically took place on the day of Pentecost, when the new birth took place and when the church was formed. Prior to that, you could have two eras. An era from the beginning of time to the time of Pentecost, to the time of Jesus, really mainly legally, we got to speak legally, to the time of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. And then an era right after that. Of course, practically, again, for the church, for our lives, happened on the day of Pentecost. So prior to that, prior to Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, there was a faith that was based on that which was visible. Let me say this again. Prior to Jesus' death, Jesus DBR, I call it, Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. The faith that most people operated was based upon that which was visible, not invisible. The faith of the New Testament, after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, or practically on the day of Pentecost onward, it was based upon that which was invisible. A faith that is based upon senses, a faith that is based upon the Word of God. Kenyon calls it our sense knowledge faith, a faith that is based upon senses. He's got a book on it, tremendous book called Two Kinds of Faith. I recommend to all of you to study that. And I'm starting on that, but I'm expounding more for us to understand how to get, where to get to understand the complete format of it. To understand this, let's go over to the book of John chapter 20. And we're going to look at verse 24. John chapter 20, verse 24. I'm reading from New King James. It says, "Now Thomas, called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came." This is after Jesus' resurrection. "The other disciples therefore said to him, 'We have seen the Lord.' So he said to them, 'Unless,'" now these guys have been living together, traveling with Jesus together, eating with Jesus for the past 3.5 years. And here is, look at what this man's saying. "So he said to them, 'Unless I see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe.' Because they nailed his hands, and also the Roman soldier stuck his spear on the side of the Lord." And so he wants to see this. "And after 8 days, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, 'Peace to you.' Then he said to Thomas, 'Reach your finger here.'" This is the first message he's bringing to the doubting one of the crowd. Thomas was the one. So much compassion the Lord has for his saints. "Then he said to Thomas, 'Reach your finger here and look at my hands, and reach your hand here and put it into my side.'" Exact same thing Thomas had said. "Do not be unbelieving, but believing." Notice the tenses Jesus uses here are the present participle, or a tense that is in action, present tense, in action. Do we call it participle in action, ing, verb? I think it's present participle. Correct us, please, if we don't know, if I'm not saying it right. And a continuous action in the present tense. I am doing this. I am going. That means I'm in the process. I'm moving. I'm moving this. I'm doing it right now. It's a present participle. It's an ing verb. So Jesus says, do not be unbelieving. You're doing that right now. You're in a process. You are unbelief. You're doing the unbelief thing. You're not walking by faith. You're walking by your unbelief. You're doing that, but be believing. But believe instead. Be believing. Use the believing part, not the unbelieving part. "And Thomas answered, said to him, 'My Lord and my God.' Jesus said to him, 'Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed.'" Now, this phrase explains two kinds of faith. Let's look at it again. "Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those," underline this verse, remember it by heart, John 20, 29. That's the key verse we're going to dwell on this. "But blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." So Jesus is saying about two kinds of faith. One that is based upon visible things, and one that is based upon invisible faith of visible. The faith based upon senses, as Kenyon says it. And the faith that is based upon the promise. We're going to talk about this in details, understanding these two operations of these two faith. Both of them are faith, but one is in a greater level than the first one. That's why Jesus says, "Blessed are those." Now, I looked up in various translations. The CEV, Contemporary English Version, says, and you can look at these notes that I have here. It says, Jesus said, "Thomas, do you have faith because you have seen me? The people who have faith in me without seeing me are the ones who are really blessed." They are what? They are really blessed. I like that. ERV, easy to read version, says, Jesus said to him, "You believe because you see me. Great blessings." Oh, I love this. "Great blessings belong to the people who believe without seeing me." Great blessings belong to the people who believe without seeing me. Now, the blessings that come as a result of the second faith, the faith that is based upon invisibility, that's God's kind of faith, has no limit to it. The faith that is based, write these phrases down. These are key phrases that are going to help you. The faith that is based upon visibility, seeing, hearing, feeling. These are the kind of faith that have lesser blessings in them, a limited blessings in them. God responded to both of them. Jesus responded to Thomas's faith. Thomas said, I have to see it. And the Lord is so good. The Lord is so gracious. Although it doesn't please him with the faith that is visible, but he still responds to people because that's all they've got. That's why today in the Islamic world, people see Jesus in a dream, in a vision, or in an open vision. Three kinds of way the Lord is manifesting himself to them. Why? Because that's the only way they would accept him. Although that kind of faith doesn't please God, faith of visibility does not please God, and I will explain why. But God responds to it. God is gracious and provides that for them because that's sometimes the only way people will respond. And that really belongs to the babes in Christ. And once you grow up, God doesn't respond to that kind of faith any longer. Unless you're really desperate and you really feel rejected and broken and feel God is not answering you, then once in a while God steps in. You know, even big kids come to mom and dad and cry and weep and act like a little kid. And you give them a baby hug. Usually you talk to them and try to put some sense into them, but sometimes they respond. They're broken, they feel lonely, rejected, a lot of emotion gets involved. And God is gracious, so is mom and dad, and they respond to that. So, but the faith that pleases the Father, the kind of faith that pleases God, is the faith that he has given us through our faith in Christ Jesus. We're going to talk about that. So now, prior to the faith of Jesus, prior to the death of Jesus and his resurrection, his burial and his resurrection, most people under the Old Testament operated by the natural faith. I like to call one a natural faith and one a supernatural faith. One based upon visible evidence, one based upon the promises of God, the Word of God. The Word of God is the only thing the supernatural base is based upon. Now, in the Old Testament, we have few exceptions of this fact, which is a mystery. Faith is really a mystery. Which is a mystery to me. I haven't still discovered it. Why people like Abraham or Enoch, why did they operate with a supernatural kind of faith? Because they did not base their faith upon that which was visible but invisible. There was some mixture in there, and we're going to look at it. We're going to study it carefully in these series that we study about faith and make sure that we don't leave any stones unturned. We're going to look at all these aspects of faith. Faith is really a mystery. And I believe the more we dig into it, the more we search, the more we're going to understand. You know, by faith movement, people like Brother Hagin and various men, Dr. T.L. Osborne, my dad in Christ, and many other people, Wigglesworth was one of them, John G. Lake, we got into the idea of faith about what faith is. But I believe that we were just beginning to tap into that, and I believe there's a lot more for us to see, to realize, to understand, and to discover as we search the Scripture and search the Word and pray, and God's grace abounding toward us in these last days, and greater manifestation of His Word is known unto us. Now, we're going to talk about those kind of faith, like Abraham's faith, Enoch's faith. But I want to talk about the usual faith that majority of the saints of God in the Old Testament operated on. For instance, let's go to the book of Exodus, chapter 3. And we're going to look at Moses, the great leader, the great prophet, if you would. And we're going to see his faith, how he was based upon and study about these and understand how they operated and how God responded, and then look at the New Testament, understanding the faith of the New Testament and how we should operate and how God responded to that. Now it says, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this. You know, it was interesting to him. Well, why is that bush on fire? Maybe a flashlight, a electrical lightning on that bush and it's caught fire, but how come it's not burning away? Great sight, why the bush does not burn? So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. Then he said, do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrow. So I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and all the Ites. Verse 9, now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppressed them. Come now. Isn't that interesting that God says, I've come down to deliver them, but now he needs Moses to do it. Verse 10, come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? And God tells him, he says, I will certainly be with you, and this shall be a sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Now notice in verse 13. Then Moses said to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, the God of your father has sent me. And then he asked, you know, who is this God? Because, you know, Egyptians believed in many gods. Now you come out of nowhere and you say, God of your father has sent me. What's your name? And he says, I am who I am. Now, we want to go down in verse 16. It says, go and gather the elders of Israel together and say to them, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, appeared to me, saying, I have surely visited you and seen what is done to you in Egypt. And I have said, I will bring you out of the affliction of Egyptian to the land of, again, he goes on through that list. And then it says, they will listen to you. And then you will go talk to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh will let the people go. I will show him the mighty hand, and so on and so forth. Now, if we go to the book of the chapter 4, we're going to look at verses 1 through 9 and see here what's happening here. Chapter 4, verse 1 says, then Moses answered and said, but suppose they will not believe me or listen to my voice. Suppose they say, the Lord has not appeared to you. So the Lord said to him, what is that in your hand? He said, a rod. And he said, cast it on the ground. So he cast it on the ground, and he became a serpent, and Moses fled from it. Then the Lord said to Moses, reach out your hand and take it by the tail. And he reached out his hand and caught it, and it became a rod in his hand, that they may, notice, verse 5, that they may believe that the Lord God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has appeared to you. See, they had to see a sign to believe God. Verse 6, furthermore, the Lord said to him, now put your hand in your bosom. And he put his hand in his bosom. When he took it out, behold, his hand was leprous, like snow. And he said, put your hand in your bosom again. So he put his hand in his bosom again and drew it out of his bosom. And behold, it was restored like his other flesh. Then it will be, if they do not believe you, nor heed the message of the first sign, that they may believe the message of the latter sign. Now, the reason the Lord is showing him a snake, because Egyptian had a god, a serpent god that they believed in and they worshiped. And Moses, by showing that he had control over that, he was talking, God was showing to Israel that he is a god that is greater than the serpent gods of Egyptians. And also, you know, they had various sick god, god of sicknesses. And so he was saying that leprosy was a tremendous sickness in those days, a kind of a curse. It's like our cancer today. And there was no cure for it. And so God was showing that he had control over leprosy, that he could heal it. Egyptians feared it tremendously. And so God was showing these signs that he's greater than all the gods of Egypt, because they worshiped that which it was they were weak toward. They worshiped serpents because they lived in desert and had many serpents, and they worshiped this disease and god of this disease, leprosy. And so God is showing here to Moses that I'm greater than these. I can cause it and I can heal it instantly. And so God is showing his power over these Egyptian gods that they worship. So now notice in verse 9, and it shall be if they do not believe even these two signs. Notice there's two signs, two manifestations, and they still not will not believe. Or listen to your voice, that you shall take water from the river and pour it on the dry land. The water which you take from the river will become blood on the dry land. Now notice, go to verse 25, I believe it is, which is not. Is it verse 30. It says, and Aaron spoken to Moses, then he did the signs in the sight of the people, all three of them. Verse 31, so the people believed. The people believed, and when they heard that the Lord had visited the children of Israel and that he had looked on their affliction, then they bowed their heads and worshiped. You see here, they had to see, these are elders of the household of Israel. These are the people that have been faithful to the God of Israel, Abraham, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Of course, you have to keep in mind that in those days, they did not have any written word. There was no written book for them to follow. Everything they believed was based upon the stories they received from their forefathers. Abraham gave it to Isaac, and Isaac gave it to Jacob, and Jacob gave it to his 12 sons. 12 sons came to Egypt, and they spread there, and they passed it on to their sons and to their sons. And here now we are four or five generations later, they have faith in God of Israel. They believe in God of Israel. And there's some doubts in there whether God has rejected them, given them up to slavery in Egypt. Whatever the case may be here, God is getting their attention. And in order for God to get their attention, he has to show them some visible manifestations in order for them to believe. Now, that is the operation of most of the people in the Old Testament. That is how people operated. Majority of the saints of God operated under that condition. Their faith was based upon, they had to see in order to believe. That's why you look at the history of Israel, the five books of Moses, and onward to the through the other books and all the prophets. Every single one of them, in order for God to get their attention, he had to do some supernatural manifestations for them to believe God. It wasn't so that God told them to do so, and they did it. That's why when Moses came down from mountain, his face was like the noonday shining. It was so bright. Have you ever looked at somebody's face so bright that you cannot look at them? Impossible. We've never seen anybody like that. But his face was so bright that Bible says people could not look into his eyes, into his face. So Moses had to put a mask on himself. Why? Because God had to show these guys, hey, Moses is not out there doing these things and come back with two tablets and say, hey, these are the Ten Commandments. He has been with me. See, everything God did, every commandment God gave Israel, every time God did something, there had to be a manifestation. They couldn't follow without a manifestation. If God wanted them, you know, the camp of Israel, they camped in the desert for 40 years. A time period that they say takes about 3 days to travel. It took them 40 years to travel. They actually went around and around and out. Round the bushes we go. What is that song goes? They went around the bush in the desert for 40 years. God, in order for them to even speak about move from here to go there, you all know that he had a cloud called as a cloud of Shekinah of glory over the tabernacle. It covered the tabernacle and the camp of Israel during the day from the heat of the sun. So they were in the shade. And at night, desert is hot during the day and hot at night. And at night, that cloud turned into a pillar of fire to keep them warm. So when that cloud moved, they had to move. So everything was visible. Everything in the temple was a visible manifestation. If God wanted Israel to do something, he had to manifest something. And even so, many of them rebelled even by seeing. Remember they saw that 10 plagues that Moses manifested before they were delivered from Egypt? And they come through the Red Sea. The Red Sea opens up before them. The ground on the Red Sea becomes completely dry. They walk on a dry ground across a population of possibly 2 million people. Cross that great ocean. On the other side, Egyptians come behind them. And after a few weeks, they say, hey, we want to go back there. Why? They miss the garlic and the onion of Egypt. They would rather live in slavery than serve God. Why? Because they miss the garlic and the onion. And that's sometimes the case with a lot of believers. They cannot give away the garlic and the onion. And they stink. They stink. So God is, in order in the Old Testament for these people to accept anything, any promises, God had to manifest supernaturally in order for them to believe. Now go over, you can see, now we can go through many stories in the Old Testament and look at and see every time that was the case with the children of Israel, God's covenant people. And we come all the way to the time of Jesus, that hasn't changed. In the time of Jesus, remember what the Jews said to Jesus when they came to him? They said, you say you are such and such, show us a sign. See, they wanted a sign. And Jesus says, this unbelieving generation, this wicked generation seeks a sign, and no other sign will be given to him. And then he gave a few examples of the Old Testament. Jonah was one of them. And really the sign he was talking about, he says, the only sign you all need is my death, burial, and resurrection. He said, here's the sign. Bring down this temple and I'll rebuild it in 3 days. They said, what? What? It took Herod 40 years to build this. What are you talking about? You crazy? Jesus, you gone crazy? There's no such a thing. You build it in 3 days? How many builders do you have? Where do you have the money? How can you build these massive construction that only takes a king to build it? What are you talking about? See, they were looking naturally. Jesus was preparing them for something greater, for some greater sign, the sign that would change them, not the sign that pleases the eyes, the sign that pleases the ears or the senses, but the sign from heaven that will change him entirely. His death, burial. That's what he was talking about. He was talking about his death. Bring down this temple. He was talking about his own body. And he says, I will rebuild it. God was speaking about it. It wasn't Jesus. It was God speaking through Jesus. And I will bring him up in 3 days. Jesus couldn't raise himself up once he was dead. The Father did it. You see, God raised him from the dead. And so in 3 days, He said, I will bring you a sign that you have never seen it before. Firstborn out of the world of the dead. Firstborn, first man righteous before God. And so, so Jesus was preparing them for, hey, there is an era coming. You don't need to see anymore in order to believe. All you need is my death, burial, and resurrection. Of course, they didn't get it. They still don't get it. A lot of them still don't get it. Thank God for those who have. And thank God for those who will. But those who don't, they will never get it. God cannot force them into it. But now, I want you to come all the way to the New Testament. We're going to look at this in more details next week. But even those who follow Jesus believed in him, so to speak, although they didn't, because their faith was based upon that which was visible again. Because Jesus, prior to his death, was still operating. Remember Galatians chapter 4 says, when the time was right, when the time was fulfilled, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. So the law was still in operation. You can see it in the life of Jesus and in the life of the disciples and the Pharisees and the Sadducees, that the law was still in operation all the way to the point of Jesus' death on the cross. The fact that in Matthew chapter 27, the curtain from the top to the bottom tore into two, the curtain that separates the holy place from the holy place, meaning that, you know, that curtain is pretty thick. It's about almost 3 inches, 10 centimeter. I've seen it, the mock-up of it. It's so heavy, hardly you can move it with one arm. That curtain takes a mighty man to tear it apart, tear it into two from top to bottom. From bottom to top, man can, but this is way high in the ceiling. Somebody from above tore it apart, meaning Shekinah lifted from the temple. Of course, at that time, there was no Shekinah. Shekinah had left a long time ago. But meaning the Holy of Holies was separated from the holy place, meaning the access, several meanings. One is the access to the Holy of Holies is no more shut off from people, meaning God has opened a way through the blood of Jesus that every man can approach him, every man, and become God's righteousness. Many other meanings it has. One, it means that the moment Jesus died, the Old Testament operation, the covenant of the Old Testament, ceased to operate, meaning God would not regard anything that regards to the law of Moses. We've talked about this extensively. I will challenge you on this subject. Many people challenge me. I can bring hundreds of verses, as I have before, to prove to you that nothing of the law of Moses was in operation. All the 613 law ceased to function. Why? Jesus fulfilled them all, every single one of them, fulfilled them all for all mankind. And now there's only one law we operate under, and that's the law of love. Jesus said, a new commandment I give you, and love one another. And so that love is the commandment of the new covenant. And Bible says that he who loves fulfill all the laws. All the law is, Jesus said, is put in these two: love your God, love your neighbor like yourself. Love. Love is the fulfillment of the law. Anyhow, when Jesus died on the cross, then the operation of the covenant of Moses, or we call it the covenant of the law, or Mosaic law, ceased to operate. No longer God respects or respected any offering that they brought, any sacrifices, any tithe. None of that was in operation when Jesus died on the cross. That was a struggle in the church in the Acts of the Apostles. We see that, and we will look at that. But a new covenant began with a new bylaws, new format, new everything. Everything has become new. I read today in Galatians chapter 3, Paul says to the Jews, he says, why do you keep the feast and the days and the seasons and the years? He's referring to the law of Moses. He says, I'm saddened for you. You act like little, you still hanging on to childish. That amazing. People are mastering in feast and the law of Moses these days. And the Bible calls it childish, step one. And they're still going back to those step ones. It's like somebody who's graduated from school. They just don't want to leave school. They love school. They love that backyard playing, swinging on the swing with the little kids. They're grown up, but they long for that. They want to go back to cafeteria and eat that junky food. Cafeteria, terrible food they had in their schools. Why? Because you grew up with it. Because you cozy up with it. Because it feels homey. Who wants to go to a new territory? Who wants to go to the new world and discover new territories and fight Indians? Nobody wants to do that. They all want to stick with something that is familiar and they're used to and smell. They know the smell. I don't want to go to a new land and to a new place and do new things. Who does? Nobody. You're always comfortable with the stuff that you used to. And so they were used to that. Look at it. Go over to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, Acts of the Apostles. I want to see this, that this operation of this faith was still in order, even under all the way to the day of Pentecost. And God had to do this to get them off of it. Notice, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, prior to this, in John chapter 20, verse 22, remember Jesus said to the disciples, and many people confuse this verse. Remember Jesus blew on them and he said, receive the Holy Spirit. Now many say, well, they'd received the Holy Spirit then. No, they didn't. The Holy Spirit wasn't on the earth to the day of Pentecost. Now, all the way to the day of Pentecost, from beginning of time to the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit, this discussion we had in our Bible study last night, in the Persian Bible study, the Holy Spirit came upon people for a short period of time for the task, supernatural task, they had to accomplish. And once they accomplished that task, he lifted from them. Because remember what God said to Noah, that no longer my spirit will no longer contend with man, in man, or remain in man. Why? Because man is sinful. And so man has no access to the Holy Spirit under the old covenant. That's why when David sinned, in Psalm 51, he prays, he says, God, do not take away your Holy Spirit from me. He enjoyed it when the Holy Spirit came upon him and he sang psalms and he prophesied. Remember when the king of Israel came to Elisha and said, Elisha, we have, I think it was Assyrian that attacked Israel, and the king didn't know what to do, and they came to their prophet because they didn't have the Holy Spirit. Although he was king of Israel, he didn't have the Holy Spirit to know what to do. So they came to the prophet, and the prophet, Elisha, says, I don't know what to do either, but bring me a psalmist. Bring me somebody who can play some instrument. They brought somebody and they started playing, dee, 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 and the Holy Spirit came upon him. It wasn't upon him before. So, and then he knew what to do. Now, in the Old Testament, they all went to the prophet. The New Testament, we don't do that. There's no such thing as going to a prophet for guidance. In the New Testament, we go to the Holy Spirit. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, Romans 8:7, these are sons of God. So now, Jesus said to them, receive, blew on him, said, receive the Holy Spirit. What was he telling them? Hey, the Holy Spirit's coming shortly. Receive him. And he just blew on him. He said, hey, it's going to be like a breath. It's going to be like a wind. It's going to be like this. Now, some evangelists and preachers tried to do that, but it doesn't work. I don't care how many tic-tac you use. It's not the same. So, but Jesus blew on him and he said, hey, listen, it's going to be like a wind. That's what he was telling him. He couldn't send the Holy Spirit then. Why? Because he hadn't died yet. He had to, he hadn't ascended unto high. He had died and rose, but he had to be ascended on high. And he says, when I go to the Father, then I send the Holy Spirit to you. And he did that on the day of Pentecost, 10 days after his ascension unto high. 10 days after day of Pentecost. It's interesting that day of Pentecost was same festivity of Pentecost in the Old Testament, which was the feast of harvest. It coincided with the exact same thing. So now, the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost, and when he came, isn't that interesting how he came? He came with mighty rushing wind. It was flames of fire. The houses started to shake. Why? We're starting the new covenant. Why manifestations? Because they wouldn't otherwise accept it, because they're still operating up to that point of the Holy Spirit coming upon them and becoming born again. They weren't born again yet. Because Jesus, remember what Jesus said to Nicodemus, for you to be born again, you've got to be born of water, which is the Word. The Word is Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. And of Spirit. The Spirit hadn't come yet. It's the Holy Spirit that gives new birth. Titus chapter 3, verse 5. So they had to be born again through the Holy Spirit. They believed in Jesus' resurrection. Now remember what the Bible says, Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. If you believe in your heart that God raised Christ from the dead and confessing with your mouth, you shall be saved. Now in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3 says that no one can confess Jesus as Lord unless by the Holy Spirit. So because the Holy Spirit hadn't come, they couldn't confess him as Lord. And their confession was based upon the visibility. So now, on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Ghost comes upon them, what happens? They become born again. So they had to get all that movement and shaking and wind and fire and shaking of the house for them to see it. Wow, this is it. This is what Jesus said. Receive the Holy Spirit. A few days from now you will be baptized in Acts chapter 1, verse 8 told them, right before his ascension. Now this is it. This is the Holy Spirit. And now that they see, whoa, the house is shaking. Whoa, I see the flames. Whoa, Peter, see, it's coming upon you. John, look, John, you get in it too. Whoa. All got excited. They all started speaking in tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. They had no idea because tongues didn't exist in the Old Testament. Nobody has spoken in tongues before. It's the first time in the history of mankind, man is speaking in the language of the Holy Ghost. Oh, Peter says, what's going on? The house is shaking. And they start speaking in tongues. There was joy. This is Pentecost. Pentecost is one of the feasts that all the male of Israel had to present themselves in Jerusalem. So people had come from all over the world to come to Jerusalem for worshiping on the day of Pentecost, a week-long festivity. And here is, they're all here, whoa, you're speaking Farsi. Oh, I hear you speaking Arabic. And they all heard, the Bible says, that the great testimonies of God in their own language. So it was a tremendous, what a revival day. What an amazing experience. But now, here's the interesting part. Here's what's getting interesting. Go over to Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8. This is Philip. There's a persecution in the church. And Philip goes to Samaria and preaches, and there's a great revival is happening. And many people, thousands of people getting saved. So the message goes back to the apostles because everybody was dispersed because of persecution except the apostles. The message comes back to the apostles. Hey, there's a great revival happening. You know, these were glorious days of the church. Holy Ghost coming, shaking, moving, tongues, people getting healed at the temple, and just a great movement in the whole Jerusalem. The whole region is shaking by the power of the Holy Spirit. This is revival time. This is the new covenant days. These are the starting of the new covenant. Oh, my God, what an amazing time. This is exciting. Philip was a server of the table. Now he comes to Samaria and there's a wow, great revival. He's preaching Jesus and people getting healed and blind eyes opening, lames are walking. Whoa, what's going on? God, the new covenant is starting, and God's engine of the new covenant is in a full force. And God is using everyone he can grab hold of that are committed to that covenant. And Philip was one, Stephen was one, and all the apostles. And notice verse 15, who when they had come down, this is, so there comes verse 14, says, now when the apostles who were at Jerusalem heard the Samaria had received the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them, who what? Who when they had come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. That's interesting. The first thing they thought of after these guys got saved, Philip the evangelist, got them all saved. And now the first thing they're thinking about, getting them filled with the Holy Ghost. Notice verse 16. For as yet he had fallen upon none of them. Isn't that interesting? And this idea that people say, when you're saved, you got the Holy Ghost. Of course you got the Holy Spirit, but you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit. See, had come upon none of them. We talked about this. The Holy Spirit is in us, with us, upon us. Upon is the baptism, and that's for the sake of the others. That's for helping us spreading the gospel and the supernatural power of God. Churches that don't believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit are powerless. They're dry as a stick, and I've met a lot of them. The Lord bless them. God loves them. They're saved, but they're dry saved. Have you eaten something dry? It's dry saved. Doesn't do anyhow. So here, had fallen upon none of them. They had only been baptized in the name of Lord Jesus. Verse 17, then they lay hands on him and they received the Holy Spirit. Notice in verse 17, there is no fire, there is no shaking, there is no wind. What happened to the wind? Is it the same Holy Spirit? How come there is no shaking going on? How come there is no wind? Listen, now that they are born again, there is no need of a visible sign. God eliminated visibility in the new covenant. We're in a new era of invisible faith, of a faith that is based upon not what you see, but what God says. Once they got it, once they were born again, there were no more needs for God showing them in order for them to believe it is there. That is the key to the new covenant faith. And that's where majority of people miss it. So many people. The other day, lady came to me and says, Pastor, I prayed for God to heal me. I believe. I said, I believe you do. I believe you do. You're a believer. If you're a believer, you have faith. That's why they call us a believer, because we have faith. Paul says we have faith. You have faith. Now, churches teach that you need to trust God more, read more Bible, blah, blah, blah. But that's not what the Bible says. Paul says, I spoke because we spoke because we have, present tense, we have faith. We're going to talk about this next week. So I said, yes, I believe you do. But she said, I don't know why it's not happening. See, I said, your happening is based upon, you're basing your faith upon what you feel, what you see, what you sense. If you don't see it, you don't believe it. And that's the Old Testament faith, not the New Testament faith. The faith of the New Testament is not based upon what I feel. See, I have pain on this shoulder because I did some sport and did something to it. And prayer-wise, I prayed. The pain is still a little bit there. This stuff doesn't go away with my prayer. It goes away with my standing on the promise. Just like I had a problem with my fingers. I had a trigger finger. And I prayed and prayed. Nothing happened. Went to the doctor. They shot a cortisone in it. It worked for 1 month. After that, it was back to the first spot. Then I came to this conclusion that this is only can get healed as it is now by me possessing the promises of God. By me taking that which God has said, has promised me in His word, by His stripes, I am, not going to be, I am healed. And then I'm standing on that and not moving and obtaining the promises, Bible says. You know what Peter says, 2 Peter chapter 1? He says, through obtaining the promises. Means the promise is there. I got to grab it, bring it from the spiritual realm, and make it a reality. Right now, healing is a theory to us until I make that healing that Jesus provided for me on the cross. And I walk on it till that becomes more actuality to me than the pain I sense on my shoulder. That is operation of the new covenant faith. In the Old Testament, a prophet had to say something. Somebody had to lay hands on me. Somebody had to do something. A manifestation, some wind, some flame, something had to happen in order for me. Wow, God answered my prayer. I saw it. It happened, but not in the New Testament. In the New Testament, this is why most Christians miss their blessings, miss their promise of God. Why? Because they're waiting for some manifestation. They're waiting for something visible. They're waiting for some sensing, some feeling in order to get it. They're not satisfied enough with the word of God. Blessed, more blessed, truly blessed are those who do not see, do not feel it, do not sense it, yet they believe it. That's why Hebrews chapter 11 verse 1 says, faith is an evidence of things not seen, not sensed. It's an evidence. I know that that word by His stripes I'm healed is greater than the pain I feel in my shoulder. I know that. And because I know that, because I operate on that, then I will see the result. Why? Not because I'm somebody special or great or no, just learning the operation of the faith that God has given me. God has given me a tool. I just got to know how to work this. The old cars, you used to put a key into an ignition and turn that key. Today's cars, you don't put a key in there. Simple. You press a button. Put your hand on a brake, press a button, the engine starts. Some people that were used to that system, they still want to stick a key into an ignition. That won't work. I took my daughter to the shop to buy a car for her. And they gave us the key, and my daughter was looking for ignition. I said, honey, haven't you seen a car like this? She goes, no, Dad, I cannot find the ignition. Where do I put this key? I said, there is no key. It's a keyless thing. She said, no. I said, yes. I said, all you got to do is just press that button, and your car will start. Some people still are looking for that key. Why? They're used to that. They're used to their prayers when they prayed when they were baby Christians and God answered it and showed them something. They're used to going to a meeting and feel God's presence. Oh, God, I want to feel you. Father, I want to feel you. Why would you want to feel him? Isn't that enough that he said, I will abide in you and you will be in me? Isn't that word enough of feeling? So this is where we're missing it. We're missing it based upon we are using a wrong key for the right covenant, a wrong key for the right setup. The right key to the new covenant is God has already done it. He has even given me faith. You all have faith. If you're a believer, you have faith. You have all the faith in the world because Peter says we have obtained like precious faith, 2 Peter 1:1. We're going to look at it next week. That same faith that was in Jesus is in you. All you got to do is just learn what it is and how to operate it. Put your key away this ignition starts with pushing a button. So push that button, put your hand on that brake, put your foot on that brake, and you'll be good to go. That engine will start. I promise you that. God be the glory. God wants us to operate according to this faith. This faith pleases the Father. And so we will. We will learn. We'll. It's not easy because we're used to senses. We're sense-led our group of people. Seeing, it's easier than not seeing. And so somebody says, hey, I got $1 million for you. Hey, show it to me. That's what they say. The proof of it is in the pudding. Give me the pudding. Let me taste it. You say it's sweet? Let me have it. Words is not good enough sometimes. But in this covenant, words is all there is to it and all there will be to it. It's those words that make it a reality and make things happen in our lives. Wow! That's awesome. This is the way God operates. Father, help us in Jesus' precious name for us to understand this faith that you have given us. A tremendous faith, a faith of God, how God operates. And you desire that we operate in the same way. The faith of the new covenant. We give you all the glory and praise. For this you have considered us mature and your sons to give us this. In Jesus' precious name. Thank you for my brethren, wherever they are. Speak blessings to them. And Lord, let them see this truth. In Jesus' precious name. I love you and I thank you for your partnership, for your faithfulness. Hang in there, whatever challenges you're facing. You have the tools to overcome it. This is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. And so God has already set you up for success. So don't back up, don't back out. Just stay with it. Stay with the word. And God will see you through by faith in Jesus' precious name. Again, thank you for all of you who are supporting us, supporting the Jod broadcast. Tremendous things are happening. And I greatly appreciate you. Lord bless you until next week. You are a winner. You were born to win with Jesus. Amen.